a little hole. And it smells too. Like, I actually think it might have been. I haven't washed it in a while. Be forewarned. Huggers in the group. What were we talking about? So the first time scripts come in, and Castiel is a warrior of God. He is, you know, full on military dude, and he's scary, you know? Like, he's all up in. He's all up in Jensen's grill, like, you know, not Jensen, whatever the other character's name is, Dean. And then very quickly, after I started portraying the character of Castiel, they modified him to be this socially awkward dork. With personal space issues and no social graces. And I can't help but think that that is a little bit more of me coming through in the character than was originally intended. So, that's enough of you. Yes, hi. Hello.
Hi. Sexual harassment can be a problem in the workforce, so how often would you say you experience sexual harassment?
There's a lot of good touches that go on there. I do know that I often am like, please, what we're doing legal, what can I say? But somebody is suing somebody over what's happening on set right now. So there's a line, and we're on the other side of it a lot of the time. It's all in good fun. Sexual harassment. I mean, I guess, yeah, I guess. So you're saying, like, if we're shooting a scene and a broomstick is tickling my balls. Okay, but if I'm enjoying it, yeah, we get a lot of those. Yeah, good. Thanks for that question. Hi.
I was wondering.
I really thought you were going somewhere serious too. Like, it's another, like, you guys haven't addressed. You've dealt with depression, blah blah blah, but not sexual harassment. But no, shame on you.
What's your favorite joke that was ever? Just kidding.
Favorite joke.
Are you ever going to write an autobiography about all the crazy shit you've done?
Oh, I really take issue with that. I don't think I've done anything crazy. I did recently start kind of journaling, sort of. I went through, I don't know why, maybe I was feeling nostalgic or something, and I went through kind of all of, oh, I know what it was. I digitized. I had this guy with a scanner come over and digitize all of our old photos and stuff. Because I thought, oh, eventually our house is going to burn down and we're going to lose this stuff. So, and I was going through all the photos and it was making me kind of dredging up old memories. And so I started sort of taking some notes on things. And I did notice that there are several things that I, in my mind, look back on and think of, wow, that was kind of awesome, crazy that you did that, good for you. And then I think, oh, but you probably shouldn't share that with other people, because they'll think that you are a sick son of a bitch. So there are some things like that fall into that category for me. Things that when I would tell you about them, you would kind of cringe and be like, really? You did that? So I don't know that I want to write that book, but yeah, I recently shot a little kind of like pilot because I had this idea for a TV show, which was just me going around breaking laws. Which I thought, I was like, oh, that would be cool, right? We should go break laws, see what happens. So my son is like, well, my dad breaks laws. And it's hard for me to explain, you know, why. Yeah, okay, I was, yeah, you were there when we were shooting that. We were breaking laws on purpose. You really lose a lot of your authority when you're like, oh, don't do that, that's against the rules. You're like, fuck you, Dad, you break laws. So anyway, I didn't answer your question. Hi.
Hello. If you were in a Marvel movie, what character would you be?
If I were in a horror movie?
A Marvel movie.
A Marvel movie. Oh, I thought you said a horror movie. And I was like, well, I'll be the knife. a Marvel movie. What? Lucky?
Bucky.
Bucky?
Deadpool, yes.
I didn't know. Captain America's spandex is a good answer. do you have a favorite? So I had a really big argument with my kids about we're trying to kind of insulate them from superhero stuff and television and pop culture in general because we feel like, oh, we want to protect their innocence and their childhood and not have them be marketed to by major conglomerates. It's a completely losing battle. Like, they're full on into the Avengers, even though they've never seen any Avengers stuff, but they know all the characters and everything that they do. And they're talking about the Hulk. I'm like, no, it's not Hulk. It's Hulk. We actually got an argument. My son started crying. I guess I was too passionate about it. It's Hulk with an L, stupid. And then I was like, okay, it's Hulk. It's Hulk. Incredible Hulk. So my favorite is the Hulk.
Hi. So. Hagerstedt's team and I, while we were building our water model raft and floating on the lake with it, we spent a lot of time listening to and watching the Cooking Fast and Fresh with West videos. And we absolutely fell in love with your two adorable children. And so I was just wondering if you could tell us, maybe you've already told us quite a few, but if you've got a specific story you'd like to tell us about your adorable children.
I'm really a one-trick pony, aren't I? This is good food for thought. I've told this story before, but I'll tell it again because I thought it was really sweet. We were lying in bed recently, and I was reading. We have a bedtime ritual. We all cozy up, one kid on each arm. We read books. We negotiate first about how many books we're gonna read. It becomes a kind of an argument. Every night it's an argument. Like, no, we're gonna read four. Like, we always, Dad, come on, let's do five, let's do six, come on. And it just sort of starts everything off on a bad note, but then we cozy in, we get comfy, we start reading, and I say, I want you guys to never grow up. I want you to never grow up, never grow up. And Mason said, no, Dad, I am gonna grow up. And I said, no, I want you to never grow up. I want you to all be my little girl. I want you to never grow up. She said, no, Dad, I am gonna grow up. I said, no, I want you to be my little girl forever. No, Dad, I am gonna grow up, and I'm gonna get old, and I'm gonna die. Killed the mood. Hi.
If you were to write a fan fiction, who would it be about and what would it be about?
That's a disgusting question.
Number two.
The Pimpmobile and the Impala.
Gabriels, you did with the crew and everything. What was the
worst or best gag that's ever pulled on you or you pulled on somebody else?
This brings up a lot of painful memories.
I don't know what is the best. What?
Change. Oh, so I played a game of word thinking for that prompt because I didn't go blank when after recall a memory that happened more than 5 minutes ago. So Jared and I were playing a game. This was, I think, 5 years ago or something, Words with Friends, the app just came out, and it became this kind of virus. Became this sort of virus on set, like, everybody was playing Words with Friends. It was taking over our lives. It was kind of bad. It was like heroin. And Jared and I played a few games against each other, and we were kind of like pretty well matched. A lot of times you play something Words with Friends, and you trounce them, and it's kind of embarrassing, so you don't want to do it again. But we were kind of well matched. And I was like, hey man, you want to play Words with Friends? And he was like, no, you know what, I've got so many games going right now. I was like, come on, let's make it interesting. We'll put some money on it. He's like, oh, all right. How about $100 a point? So however many points you beat that person by, it's $100. I was like, well, did a little math and realized like, no, if you beat me by 10 points, it's $1,000 and I can't afford that, so no. How about $10? And he said, sure. And usually the point spread at the end of a game is something like, you know, 20 points or something like that. He beat me by 160 points, which has never happened before or since. It was awful. It was horrific. It was like Z's on triple word scores in every direction. Ugh. And so I got $1,600 worth of Canadian pennies and nickels and dumped them on the floor of his trailer. Which made the bitter pill of losing all that money and just losing a little bit sweeter. Just a little bit. Because it was a real pain in the ass for him. And then he wrote a note that said, donation for random acts, and he dumped most of that change back into my car. So like, in a weird way, I kind of lost like 3 times. And still to this day, when I break, suddenly I hear shh. Change somewhere in the car, bumping against it. So,
hi.
Nope. Change. That's a really good question. Yes. So we had a scene. This was maybe season 6 or something like that. We had a scene. I was a little hoarse, probably from training. Beat Castiel, and there was a bad thing coming. We were shooting a scene. I don't fucking remember what it was. There was some bad thing coming, and it was like light blasting through the windows, and I screamed, "Watch your eyes!" That was my line, right? But every time I did the line, it was like, "Watch your eyes!" And it was like a teenage boy whose voice was just changing, and I couldn't get the line out, but I was like, "Watch your eyes!" So now, anytime there's any kind of like danger thing or safety warning or anything like that on set, everybody in the crew goes, "What are you doing?" Which is awesome.
So when Cass became human, we learned that he had to kind of teach himself how to be human. He learned how to drive. He learned how to feed himself, how to clean himself up and everything. Can you tell us something about his experience in one of those, like how he learned to drive, how he learned he needed to eat or use the bathroom?
How does Cass learn to wipe? That's an interesting question. Because usually children are exposed to these things gradually, they see their parents doing stuff, they learn, but Castiel probably one day just found himself taking a crap and then being like, is that a stall? I'm a little scatological, aren't I? Thanks for being a touchstone there, that's good. Getting a little constructive feedback from the front here. You like to talk about poop, don't you? Great, thanks. Hi.
Hello. First, I'd like to compliment you on...
Oh, great, yes.
...how comforting you are during photo ops for people at their first photo op, and just thank you very much, as I was having an anxiety attack.
Well, thank you for saying that. A lot of times I do try to make people extremely uncomfortable. You happen to just be lucky. You caught me off guard.
My question for you is how do you, Misha, feel about playing Lucifer?
I feel good about it. To get to, you know, do something completely different from Castiel for a change. It was a little daunting at first, I'll admit, because I got the script and it was kind of, you know, some kind of meaty stuff with me playing the character that Mark Pellegrino has established. And Mark Pellegrino is probably the best actor we've had on the show. He's done such an awesome job with Lucifer that there's actually no way I could measure up, so they were setting me up for a failure. So that was a little bit nerve-wracking actually for me, but I went over to Mark Pellegrino's apartment and cheated. For the first scene, I was like, hey Mark, I've got a funny question. Could you show me exactly how you would do this?
Play Castiel, play Jimmy, play, you know, Misha in that episode where boys jump to another universe.
Yeah, the French mistake.
The French mistake, thank you. Yeah. And then finally Lucifer, as a performer, how is it like to switch from role to role to role? Kind of?
It's good. I have whiplash, but it's good. You know, I think that there are a lot of shows where you just play one character the whole time. And it's been fun for me to get to, you know, bounce around and play totally different characters, albeit all in the same physical form, which is good, because they would have had to hire other actors to do it if it wasn't in the same physical form. I'm just following that to its logical conclusion. I think when Castiel was portrayed by that girl, I can't remember her name, but she was about 10 years old. She was Jimmy Novak's daughter. That was young. No, I don't mean the character's name, but thank you. I guess I should have known. I should have said Claire just now. Anyway, I think that was the best portrayal of Castiel as we've seen. But it was a different actor. I've lost the thread. Hi.
Okay, so I know that Charlie's death took a big toll on Castiel, and it's probably like one of the big reasons why he said yes to Lucifer. It's what I took from it. I was wondering how you, as Misha, took a loss of a feminine role and a big representation of a minority.
I've talked about this a little bit in the past, but. I loved and loved the character of Charlie and Felicia's portrayal. And I thought it was great that we had a character on the show who was gay, who the fact that she was gay was not what the character was about at all. I think that is a step forward in general, in terms of I think representation is really key. I actually believe, I mean, it's one of the reasons that I'm interested in working in film and television in general. I feel like it can help, it can be kind of a vanguard for social change. It can make things accessible or acceptable that hadn't previously been. There was a long time in cinema history, there's a movie about this, it's a documentary, and I can't remember the title of it. But it's about how gay characters, for the longest time in cinema, were either bad guys, or they had to die or meet with some tragic demise by the end of the movie. Like, that was sort of just an unwritten rule that was adhered to in American cinema for a really long time. And then we went through this period in like the 90s, and it felt like there was a lot of gay characters on television, but they were kind of like, it was all about the like, how funny that there's a gay character here. So I really liked that Charlie was an awesome, grounded, funny character that we could relate to, who happened to be gay, but it wasn't about her gayness. I thought that was great. And I also think that, I mean, people have like complained a lot about the fact that she was both a woman and gay, and she died on the show. And first of all, you know, it's Supernatural, and there's no one's really dead forever. So, I mean, I've died 7 times, and nobody complains about that. Except for the people that hate Castiel and wish I would stay dead. But the truth is, I think we can't have sacred cows on the show. Like, if you knew as an audience member that a character was not going to die because they were a woman, and we you know, don't allow women to die on the show, but because they're gay, we don't allow gay characters to die, it would lose a lot of its dramatic value. That said, there are sacred cows on the show because we know that Sam and Dean are never going to die. So it's not really true. What did he say? But anyway, that's how I feel about it. I mean, I'm sad to have lost the character if we didn't have in fact lost her, but I don't know in the long run. Anyway, there. I think I've said it. Thanks. Hi.
I would just like to know what the most troubling
event is working on the set. Oh, there have been several instances where I've gotten in trouble. Where I've gotten phone calls from the producers telling me to stop. I've heard that Warner Brothers has called the producers and asked the producers to ask me to stop. And the producers were like, you deal with them. And then Warner Brothers didn't call me. So that's cool. But now I get those calls. I'm not going to rehash those things, but I get those calls. Yeah, it sucks. Because there are people that are calling you to reprimand you that could kill your character really easily. So you have to really kiss up a little bit. Yeah. It's a little life lesson for you. Hi.
Hi. So as we know, these current casts are stuck together 24/7 right now. And as we've recently realized, cast is not completely locked away. So my question is, what would a conversation between Castiel and Lucifer be in his head?
I will tell you, spoiler alert, we'll cover your ears if you don't like that sort of thing. That we will be seeing that conversation in the future. Pretty weird thing. There's going to be a bunch of people talking in Castiel's head. Yeah. Weird shit happens on this show. And some seriously weird stuff is coming down the pipe. I've told some of my friends about some of the stuff that's in the scripts that we're shooting, the final scripts that we're shooting now. That's awesome. Really close friends. They're like, I think I might watch the show. I might actually watch that. Most of my friends have never seen the show, so they really care about me.
So, if Castiel refuses to expel Lucifer because he thinks he's the only one who can stop the darkness, how are Sam and Dean going to get him out of Cass without killing Cass?
This is like the $64,000 question, isn't it? think, like, all right, I'm going to ask him a question that there's no way he's going to be allowed to answer. And see how he deals with it. Is that what you're thinking?
Pretty much, yeah.
Thanks a lot. Like, way to hang me out to dry here. Yeah. So how are they going to get Cass out of Lucifer's... I mean, how are they going to get Lucifer out of Cass's vessel?
Yeah.
Is that what you're asking?
Yeah, like, without killing him. Like, if you had control over getting Lucifer out of Cass without killing him, how would you do it?
With jelly beans. And then Lucifer would be like, oh, Cass... Hi.
Hi, Misha.
I was going down a rabbit hole just now, and I jumped out. Hi.
Hi. So, I just want to say you're an awesome father.
Cry about the pronunciation of Hulk, please.
So based on your parenting,
yes.
What would you suggest would be an appropriate discipline for my son, Jensen?
You have a son named Jensen?
Yes, we met him 4 years ago.
Oh my goodness. How is Jensen doing? Now, so wait, is Jensen now 4 or 5?
He's 9 now.
He's 9. Oh my God. Are you, so, and he's a little bit of a handful, huh, I bet?
Yeah, he actually called me just now, and I declined the call because I wanted to ask you the question.
I think right there, that's a great mark of good parenting.
I can FaceTime him.
Just so, is Jensen is, all right, I mean, yeah, if you're going to name your son Jensen at the outset, I think you know he's going to be a pain in the butt.
Very much so.
Yeah. Do you strike him at all?
Yes.
Great. Okay, that wasn't the answer I was looking for. So if you said no, then I could say, well, you should hit your children. I would be a little bit of a joke. But since you already beat him, some of the comic value is lost there. My mom, I was 9. No, I was much older. I was 10. And my mom was dropping me off at school, and I don't know what she said, she said something, and I said something, and I was like, I hate you, Mom, you know, something like that. And she slapped me in the face. Now, my mom, I mean, I was a pain in the butt, I'm sure. And she slapped me, I think, twice my entire childhood, which really showed tremendous restraint on her part. And she slapped me, and it wasn't like, you know, close-fisted or anything. It was just, you know, you little brat. By some miracle, he gave me a bloody nose. And so I immediately leapt out of the car, and I ran into school. Called her in, get come in to have a meeting. Awesome. Anyway, I would say you're doing the right thing. Keep it up. Keep up the good work. Just don't let him bleed in front of his teachers would be my main advice.
Thank you.
Hi.
Hi. You've been doing a lot of charity work, especially through Grand Max, and you've even moved that charity work into inspiring people within Gishwas to reach out to their community as well as part of have you ever considered maybe making a documentary in regards to your charity work and then possibly maybe going to schools to speak to do more community outreach?
God, that sounds like a lot of work. one of the things that we are trying to get better at, right? We have this funny thing, which is one of the main goals of Random Acts is to try to show people that it just takes a small effort to make a big impact on someone's life. But initially, I really wanted to try to kind of document all of the, as many of the acts as we did as possible, like film it. The thing is, it actually can get kind of weird because it's like, here, I'm giving you something, and do you mind if I film it? It's like such a strange self-aggrandizing dynamic and makes people feel uncomfortable.